the case presentations, tumor board, and also the medical colleges. We are trying to upgrade our medical colleges, as we know that the malignant cases, the patient, maximum patients at first, they attend to their nearby medical college, and maximum patients, they do not come to the referral hospital, that is oncology center. And our, the medical college, the teachers, they have to treat the maximum cases, what they get, and they try to refer the patients. And so we are trying our, the medical, these medical colleges, they, what they are doing, we think that we are doing what we are doing right or wrong, we want to present in this session. And from this session, we can upgrade our knowledge, and our, the, all the doctors, they can know the, how can they can treat the patients and what are wrong and what, how can to rectify them. And today our presenting medical college is M. Abdul Rahim Medical College, which is the northern part of Bangladesh, and it is near Jalpaiguri. That's nearby. This is the border area of the Jalpaiguri. And the moderator of this today's session is Professor Dr. Shahi Farzana Tasnim. And I request our, the chairperson of today's session, Professor Dr. Amy Hai, sir, who is the president of the Oncology Club, to give us permission and say a few words for starting the session. Sir, please.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Thanks, Dr. Sahana. Heartfelt thanks to the participants today. And I welcome Dr. Angela Kinag. She's already a member of, I think we are a member of Oncology Club. She's already with us. Also, we are expecting Dr. Seema Gulia. Penny Kathy is already with us. She always remains with us. And I congratulate Dinajpur, Abdul Rahim Medical College and Hospital, Dinajpur, particularly the Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology, for taking part in helping us in our endeavor. Today, our moderator will be the Dr. Sai Farzana Tasnim, and presenters are Dr. Ishrat Sarmin and Rivaida Gulshanara. Welcome all of them. Thanks for my hard work. So, Farzana, please start immediately with Dr. Ishrat.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Today's faculties, the renowned faculties, they are all, we think that, as rightly said, our sir, Professor Dr. A.M. Hai, sir, the Dr. Bhagyalakshmi Nayak and Dr. A.K. Goodman, they are no longer the faculties. They are our member, and we are so happy by knowing this. And also the another faculty today is Dr. Seema Gulia. She is professor of Department of Medical Oncology, Tata Memorial Hospital, Mumbai. And Bhagyalakshmi Nayak, she is professor Department of Gynae Oncology in Acharya Horihar Postgraduate Institute, Chutok. And Dr. A.K. Goodman, you all know her. I request Professor Dr. Shahi Farzana Tasnim. She is the professor and head of the Department of Obstetric and Gynecology in M. Abdul Rahim Medical College and Hospital to moderate the session. Over to you, Shahi Farzana.
Thank you, Professor Shahana Parvin. Thank you, Professor Shahana Parvin, for giving me the opportunity. Assalamu alaikum and a very good evening to you all. This is Professor Shahi Farzana Tasnim. Welcoming you all to today's continuing medical education series, Addressing Challenges and Opportunities, organized by Oncology Club. And the presenting medical college is my medical college, that is Abdul Rahim Medical College. March, the month of independence. So first of all, I would like to extend my humble tribute to all the freedom fighters who sacrificed their life in the liberation war. It's my immense pleasure to moderate today's session and announce the name of today's international faculties, Dr. Seema Gulia. She is the professor of medical oncology, TMH, Mumbai, India. And another faculty is Professor Dr. Bhagyalakshmi Nayak. She is our most favorite and our own personality. We are very much happy to have you with us, Dr. Bhagyalakshmi Nayak. She is the professor of gynecologic oncology, HPIC, Q-Tech, India. And today we are going to have two presenters among us. First of all, our first speaker is Dr. Ishrat Sharmin. She is working as assistant professor of obstetrics and gynecology, M. Abdul Rahim Medical College, She will give her presentation on statistics of Abigail Department of M. Abdul Rahim Medical College of 2021. Our second speaker is Dr. Jubaida Gulshanada. She is working as a consultant of Abigail Department. She will be presenting three cases of ovarian tumor, and if time permits, she will talk on persistent molar pregnancy. Before starting the session, I would like to say a few words regarding my medical college. I have been posted here 3 months ago as a professor of obstetrics and gynecology. This is a medical college in northern zone of Bangladesh. You have already come to know from the speech of Professor Shahana Begum, Shahana Parveen. This is a tertiary medical college situated in the northern zone, and we have to feed a lot of people in this northern zone. But what I have seen in this medical college after my joining, there is various scarcity of logistic and manpower. And we have no radiotherapy machine, we have no frozen section facilities, and there are so many lacking in our facilities. But without this, during this pandemic, our department served a lot to serve the distressed people of this zone with this low resource setting. So I hope and pray that this seminar will be very much useful for us, that what we'll be learning from today's series, that we will be able to learn how to serve the distressed people from the low resource setting from our national and international faculties. So now, with the kind permission of our chairperson, Professor Mihai sir, I would like to invite our speaker. Sir, should I call upon?
Yes, please.
Thank you, sir. First of all, I would like to call upon Dr. Ishat Sharmin. She is the assistant professor of Abigail Department, M. Abdul Rahim Medical College. She will present the statistics of Abigail Department of 2021. Dr. Ishat Sharmin, over to you, please.
Thank you, madam. Assalamu alaikum and good evening to all. Would I audible to all?
Yes.
Am I audible, ma'am?
Yes. Yes.
Okay, thank you. Assalamu alaikum and good evening. M. Abdul in Gynae Ops Department, the total patient is 5,000. Thank you. Statistics from February 2021 to January 2022. The total patient in our OBS and Gynae department were 5,578. Among them, the Gynae cases were 929. Among 929, the total genital malignancy were 66. That is the 7.11% of total Gynae cases. The total cases 66, and among them the carcinoma of the cervix, the total cases 21, and the ovarian cancers were 29 in number, and persistent gestational trophoblastic tumor were 12 in number. The endometrial carcinoma were 3 in number, and vulval carcinoma was 1. The total surgeries for genital cancer we have done were primary debulking surgeries, 5 in number, then total abdominal hysterectomy with bilateral salpingectomy with preservation of both ovaries, we did 3 in number. The total abdominal hysterectomy with bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy, 3 in number, then post neoadjuvant chemotherapy debulking surgeries, we did 2 in number. This is a pie chart. The most of the cancer is ovarian malignancy, for which we did I did debulking surgery. Now I say something about carcinoma cervix admitted in M. Abdul Rahim Medical College Hospital in last 12 months, and it was 21 in number, and all are paras lady, and they got married below age of 15. That is, early marriage is one of the cause of carcinoma cervix, we know. All are paras, and the maximum patients were menopausal in our hospital. And most of the patient, the symptoms were parvaginal discharge, parvaginal bleeding, lower abdominal pain, and one patient come with urinary complaint. And rectovaginal examination shows left parametrium, most of the patients were involved left parametrium 10 in number, that is 48%. So most of the patient, about 14 out of 21, is stage 2B. So in our hospital, all are advanced and inoperable stage, so they are referred for radiotherapy in Rangpur Medical College Hospital, Bogra Medical College Hospital, and National Institute of NIRCH. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank
you. About my part.
Thank you, Dr. Ishaq, for your wonderful presentation. Thank you so much. Dear audience, you have seen that in spite of pandemic, in spite of low resource and lack of manpower and logistics, our OB-GYN specialist worked hard to serve the malignant patient. And you have seen the percentage of the malignancy in our institute is 7.11%. And most of the cases were advanced malignancy, so that we couldn't do anything. And from the regarding surgery, we have done primary debulking surgery, TH with BLS with preservation of both ovaries, and post-NAT debulking surgery. These are our outcome of our gynecologist. So thank you, Dr. Rishad. Lastly, we'll take comments from our faculties. Now, I would like to call upon Dr. Jubaida Gulshanara to present her cases. Dr. Jubaida Gulshanara, over to you. Dr. Jubaida, are you here? Dr. Jubaida, can you hear me?
She's absent now.
Dr. Jubaida, are you here?
She's absent now, ma'am.
No, no. So she's here.
She's here. Tina Messi.
She said. জি আমার পাশেই আছে ওর যে ল্যাপটপে একটু সমস্যা হচ্ছে
ডাক্তারটা দিয়ে বলু
ডাক্তারটাকে পাঠিয়ে দেন আমাদের কাছে
না
আমাদের দিয়ে হতো তো সাম টেকনিক্যাল প্রবলেম প্লিজ
আই থিং ইন দা মিন টাইম देयर आर सम क्वेश्चंस
यस देयर आर सम क्वेश्चंस Doctor Ishad, how did you do the staging? Only by clinical examination or examination under anesthesia or by advanced imaging? How did you do your staging? Ishad, Dr. Ishad.
We do parvaginal clinical examination at first, but most of the patient we do clinical examination, parvaginal, rectovaginal examination, and if there is no difficulties, then we do only parvaginal and rectovaginal examination. Examination under anesthesia. I want to know the examination under anesthesia is necessary for all the patients.
How many cases needed examination under anesthesia, madam?
Out of 21, we do 9 patients for examination under anesthesia.
Okay. Is it that the patient was not cooperative, or what was the problem that we did examination under anesthesia?
When the patient is very much. We do examination under anesthesia when we need a thorough clinical examination, and when we think there is extension to urinary bladder or parametrium up to the pelvic wall, then for clear perception, we do examination under anesthesia.
Okay. So, do you use imaging also?
Yes, ma'am. We do. We do CT scan. We do and chest X-ray.
Okay. I just wanted to know if we are able to access CT scan, then why do we do an examination under anesthesia? Because that's again a morbid procedure. You expose anesthesia.
When ma'am, CT scan is not available, some patient cannot do did it, then we do an examination under anesthesia. But when patient came with a CT scan, we did not do it.
It's not mandatory.
As I see, all the cases were all advanced cases. So all were referred for radiation. None were operated here. The only thing is that on which basis you send them for radiotherapy, whether it's a cytology or a biopsy?
No, ma'am. We do cervical biopsy for histopathology examination.
Okay. Biopsy, do you do them upfront when they come to your OPD, or you admit them and under anesthesia you take the biopsy?
Pardon me, ma'am.
No, I just wanted to know whether you are OPD. Doing the biopsy upfront when the patient comes to you directly in your OPD, or you admit them and then take them for biopsy in the OT, maybe at a later date.
No, ma'am. We have to admit these patients in our inpatient ward. Then we prepare them by CBC urine examination, chest X-ray, and arrange whole fresh blood if there is any incidental heavy bleeding, then we do an biopsy.
Okay, how long does the biopsy take to get the report, histopathology report? How long does it take?
In our hospital, at least 7 to 10 days needed for histopathology report.
Okay. So, Kamaluddin sir, Rabbi wants to speak something.
Yeah. Please raise hand, Dr. Kamaluddin.
Dr. Shana, do you agree that we have to admit the patient, keep her,
Usually, you don't need to admit the patient for taking biopsy, as because it is very easy to take cervical biopsy.
Yes.
As Dr. Ishrat, you got training from our hospital, and you have seen our OPD, and you are attending in our OPD during that November, and you have seen that we have the minimum 60 to 70 patient per day, 60 to 70 say cervix patient per day in our OPD. And we can easily take the biopsy, just only a biopsy forceps.
Yes,
only a distal biopsy forceps or other biopsy forceps. What type of biopsy forceps available? You can take the biopsy in OPD, and no necessity of the admission of the patient.
Yes, ma'am.
Some of no necessity of admission of the patients, but still we are seeing that the in different medical colleges and who are not accustomed to taking this type of biopsy, they admit the patient and side by side they prepare the patient and improve their general condition. And not only that, the patient has become the severe anemic. They improve the patient, give blood transfusion, and side by side all other admitting patients, because if the patients are admitted in hospital, they get the investigation free of cost when they're admitted in the hospital.
Yes.
In that cases, they may admit the patient for taking the biopsy.
Yes, ma'am. That's true.
Yes, exactly.
Dr. Shana, we can take the biopsy in the OPD and admit the patient, so that by the time the patient is resuscitated, gets blood, by the time the histopathology is ready.
Yes, yes.
Yes, ma'am.
We routinely admit the biopsy in our OPD. Routinely.
Yes, I think that's a very important message you should give, because we also face the same thing. Because the patients are admitted in the medical colleges for 10, 15 days, anesthesia checkup, pre-anesthetic checkup, cardiology, then they will do the biopsy, and then that will take again another 15 days to come. So I think in the OPD upfront, you can take a biopsy. It is not at all so dangerous. In case that happens, you can give a pack, or I think it's manageable.
Dr. Ishat, you have seen that in our OPD, just only a one or two biopsy for say, just several four or five the cascos speculum, and just only a boiler, just a for the some and just one a kidney tray and only as a boiling machine, that is enough. You can boil the instrument and take the biopsy. After taking the biopsy in the chlorine solution, and you can again reuse it. So
yes,
you don't need to admit the patient on the day of the attending.
All patients are not admitted. Okay. When they are debilitating, when there is anemia, then that patients were admitted in inpatient. But other patients who are almost healthy, they are the biopsy taken outdoor patient.
Bhagya, I have one question for you. A non-surgeon people is asking a question. How are you? So I overhear that there was a discussion that if there is a CT available, EUA may be excluded. My question is always a CT can replace EUA when it is a doubtful case of a surgically operable case? So whether we should trust our finger or we should trust the CT image? Say it is an operable, borderline operable case, we are taking a decision. For advanced case, I agree, the imaging is fair. But when we are talking about an operable case, 1B1, 1B2, or 1B3, I mean, those gray zone area. So I think, maybe I'm wrong, MRI better than CT, but nothing is better than the two finger. The palpation is the best thing. Unless you palpate and see that the parameter is involved, probably nobody can give you the best. So, the examination of a gynecological oncologist is the best tool among all the imaging still in the world for a borderline situation. So, for advanced stage, imaging is fine, but early stage, when we are taking a decision, clinical examination is the tool. And all the imaging will be the support for that. Nothing can replace the clinical examination.
Yes. Clinical examination and intervention under anesthesia. I think it depends upon the who is doing the clinical examination. As all we know, who are regularly that doing the clinical examination, who are regularly they are attending the malignant cervix patient. That is, it is easy for them to evaluate whether it is operable to take the decision. But in that setting, that is like the medical college hospital, who are not regularly attending this type of patient, in these cases, if they are confusing that, they will, whether they will go for the surgery or will they send the patient for radiotherapy. In that cases, I think there is a gray zone whether it is operable, inoperable. In that cases, EUA is, I think it is necessary.
Yes, for us, a very practical way of how we go about it is that in the OPD, of course, if you are in a doubt, you always tell your colleague also to confirm whether it's operable or not. So that's one way. And the next is if it is operable or not operable. So we always, of course, barring the thing, you should have an MRI in hand. So in very early cases, we do this MRI to confirm whether it's operable or not. But still then, we keep our EUA option on the OT table.
Yeah.
So just before proceeding for surgery, again, we confirm our findings. So it's, I think, a three-pronged approach. One is in the OPD, one is with MRI, and the third is again on the OT table just before operating.
So, Bhagya, what I want to tell that nowadays we are having so many wonderful images like CT scan, MRI, PET CT, whatnot. But so probably we are going out of the clinical examination and more trusting of the images, which is not good. Yes, and it should not be.
Yes, that is so important. And again, if you do your MRI, you have to read it yourself. Because many times the radiologist doesn't know what you have already felt or seen.
Exactly.
Yes. So many times it happens that they would give parametrial indication when clinically accurate, there's nothing.
Ma'am, I would like to ask one question to you for clarity. As after Figo, my revised revised staging of 2018, we don't practice EUA regularly for all patients. We do a clinical examination. And ma'am, if necessary, which will be the better option? It is the MRI or CT scan for carcinoma service for staging.
No, for early stages, whether to see whether it's for soft tissue marking, I think MRI is a much better one. And for nodal status and parameter extension towards the pelvic wall, all those things, and bladder invasion, all those things, actually, we depend on advanced cases on CT scan. Early stages, we depend on MRI.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Dr. Jubaida? Dr. Ishrat?
And I think Dr. Shana? I think please also deliberate a bit about how to take a biopsy, because many times in 3 weeks, if the biopsy is superficially taken, then the biopsy report after 10 days will be negative for
necrotic tissue. Not only that, biopsy should be taken with the healthy tissue, because sometimes there is a necrotic tissue. And so we cannot confirm that that tissue is necrotic tissue and inadequate tissue. So final histopathology report cannot be. And again, the patient, there again 10 to 15 days delay for getting the histopathology report.
Just add that for our younger colleagues, when you are thinking that it's a patient of CA cervix, add speculum examination. So it has to be again very gentle, because if you go and directly get the speculum bled to the growth, I think the bleed profusely. So again, the insertion of the speculum should also be very, very gentle. And to follow the vaginal wall.
Dr. Rabia Khatun,
Dr.
Ishrat,
Jubaida is here.
Jubaida, any problem?
Yes, no, ma'am. I start.
Okay. Thank you. Now, I would like to call upon Dr. Jubaida Gulshanara, consultant of the GYN department, Imam Abdul Rahim Medical College, to present her cases. Dr. Jubaida Gulshanara, over to you, please.
Assalamu alaikum, madam.
Wa alaikum
Excuse me, sorry for technical problem. I tried.
Jubaida, please minimize your presentation at first, then you can show.
Okay.
Yes.
Yes, it has come. Enable editing. Right side. Upper part, enable editing. Please mute yourself, except the speaker, please. There's so many added sounds.
My past case is
okay.
My past case is Mrs. Shahanas.
It was okay. What is happening? At first, you minimize your presentation, then.
Yeah. Mrs. Shahanas, a 46-year-old woman.
We can see. Jabaida, we can see.
Share screen, current. Share screen. Need to again, apne dekhat chilen.
Share screen.
Ek to again, apni screen share kar lo.
Share it. Share.
Slides are visible.
I can share.
Okay. Okay.
My first case is my patient, Mrs. Shahanas, a 46-year-old woman, para two living two, housewife of lower socioeconomic family, attendant in M. Abdul Rahim Medical College Hospital, with the complaints of non-case of malignant ovarian tumor, received 6 cycles new adjuvant chemotherapy, completed on 13 June 2021. And her ultrasonogram revealed right adnexal mass measuring about 10.4 into 7.5 centimeters. According to the patient statement, she underwent total abdominal hysterectomy on 2014, but her documents were not shown. Then her laparotomy was done on 2022. But unfortunately, surgery cannot be completed. Only ascitic fluid for cytology and tissue was taken from adnexal mass. And her cytology revealed negative for malignant cell. Histopathology report showing metastatic endometrioid carcinoma. Then she referred to oncologist and 6 cycles of chemotherapy was given, which was completed on 13 June 2021. Her bowel and bladder habit was normal. There was no family history of breast, ovary, colon cancer. On general examination, patient nothing abnormalities detected. On her part abdominal examination, there was heart, there was mass. There was firm mass, palpable lump in the right left. And it was also felt on paravaginal examination, right side of the vault. And her ultrasonogram of whole abdomen, which was done on 26 June 2021, showing right adnexal mass, measuring about 10.4 centimeter into 7.5 centimeter. And there was no ascites present. Her CA125 results revealed 12.7 unit per ml, which is normal. These are ultrasonogram reports showing mass in the right adnexal. And her CT scan of whole abdomen on 5th July 2021, which revealed adnexal one large complex cystic mass about 8.7 into 14.3 into 13.2 centimeter in size. There was no ascites present, multiple large parietic lymph node in infradenal level, and large lymph node measuring about 1.9 into 3.3 centimeter and 2.2 into 1.5 centimeter. Then her laparotomy followed by internal debulking surgery was done in M. Abdul Rahim Medical College Hospital on 18 July 2021, including removal of adnexal mass, total omentectomy, resection of enlarged parietic lymph node, and also resection of colonic epiploecy. Her histopathology revealed undifferentiated neoplasm and peritoneal lavage showing atypical cell present. Then patient is follow-up, but patient referred to oncologist, but patient cannot regularly follow up on the oncologist. And after patient, we done a ultrasonogram on 16 February 2022, that is a repeat normal study, and HRCA 125 repeat normal study on 16 February 2022. Now question session.
My request is Dr. Bhagalokhi Nayak, madam. What the fallacy we are seeing in treating these patients? Please minimize your session. Stop your screen share. Again, your screen share. Dr. Bhagalokhi Nayak, ma'am, please.
Yes, yes. Thank you so much, Dr. Shahana. I think this is quite a common scenario in India as well. So we really don't have enough infrastructure also to manage such patients. And many times it's also a fault from the patient side. Maybe we have not counseled them properly to come to the proper place where they could get the proper treatment. So I think she was opened and closed in 2020. So nothing could be done. And then chemotherapy was given, and then she has responded, and then she had another surgery. Am I right?
Yes.
Yes. And now this surgery has been quite fruitful as of now, because the CA125 was never raised. It was not in the post chemotherapy also. We don't have any much raised CA125. So we cannot use this CA125 as a marker. And number two is that the biopsy was undifferentiated ovarian cancer. So I think now we are actually in a soup to know, find out what it really is. So for the pathologist, I think it is difficult because she already had 6 cycles of chemotherapy. After 6 cycles of chemotherapy, the histopathology many times becomes a little distorted comment. So that is one issue. But then I think some kind of IHC should be done. But Ishrat, I think we had a biopsy report in the beginning before giving chemotherapy. So what was the biopsy report? It was endometrioid carcinoma.
Yes.
Yes.
Endometrioid carcinoma. So I think we have to go with that only, that the biopsy, because that was the post pre-op. But then if there is any disparity, we can go with IHC of the initial tissue block if we have. So that will give you better result than the post NSCT tissues. And what about the omentum and all those things? They were all negative.
All negative.
All negative. And the nodes were positive.
Nodes, sir.
Nodes positive. Biopsy, post op biopsy, nodes were positive.
Positive.
Yes. So I think we'll have to. This is a little peculiar case because there is no ascites, as you see. So because I think there is no ascites, so we really don't have any upper abdominal disease. Because the ascites is the main culprit, which actually takes all the cells to the upper abdomen, and it then gets lodged there and then grows into huge masses in the diaphragm, in the protohepatis and all those things. So I think no ascites is a blessing in disguise. So now this tumor has a propensity to spread to the lymph nodes. So the lymph nodes are enlarged, but there is no ascites and there is no upper abdominal disease. So this, there are, I think, more shortly we'll be having the molecular classification of the tumors which have a propensity for lymph node metastasis and which have a propensity for ascites and upper abdominal disease. So I think in a few more years we will really have some kind of classification about this. But I think this patient will, overall the prognosis will be good for this patient because she has responded to chemotherapy well, and the disease, I think the surgery has been done properly. And there is no upper abdomen disease. We have not left any disease behind. And most of the time, the post-operative complications, the recurrences, the intestinal obstruction, everything happens due to the intra-abdominal disease which has been left behind. But here, these are most of the disease is in the lymph nodes. So lymph nodes, usually they will not cause obstruction or all those things which really happens in ovarian cancer and pulls down the patient very badly. The general condition of the patient becomes so poor. So I think on the whole, the patient will be doing well. So is Dr. Gulia there? Dr. Seema, are you there?
Yes. Yeah, hi, good evening.
Good evening. I think, you can add some points on this.
Yeah, so thank you. So I completely agree with Dr. Bhagyalakshmi that this patient
will have a good prognosis, because if you look at the history in detail, she had disease in 2014 and at that time she was not treated adequately because she has received chemotherapy and no surgery was done. And then in 2020 she again had some another surgery. But one point which I would like to stress here, that in ovarian cancer, treatment cannot end at surgery. Even if patient has received 6 cycles of chemotherapy in the beginning, in the new adjuvant setting, post-surgery, the patient should receive 2 or 3 cycles of adjuvant chemotherapy depending upon the tolerance to prior chemotherapy.
Yes, and chemotherapy should have been continued because we have still have residual
disease. Yeah, still have residual disease. And if I remember correctly, this patient did not receive adjuvant chemotherapy. I understand that there are compliance issues both at the patient level. And even after, Dr. Ishrat has mentioned that she was advised to go to the oncologist, but she did not follow up. So we have to make the patient understand that now surgery is done. So she has to continue another 2 or 3 cycles of chemotherapy so that the chances of recurrence are reduced further.
I think Dr. Rupinder is also there.
Yeah, Dr. Rupinder, Dr. AK.
Yes, we can take their views also.
Dr. Rupinder, ma'am?
No, sorry, I came in a little late actually. So I've just heard the tail end of the whole thing. And I can only comment that there can never be any substitute for complete treatment. And yes, when recurrence occurs, no, it does occur in a way. Sometimes we cannot really figure out whether it is whether the original carcinoma was endometrium or a disseminated endometrium or a ovarian. Because when ovarian cancer recurs, it doesn't recur in a uniform fashion. You know, all no matter what the original histopathology has been, recurrence of ovarian cancer can be. You can have a small deposit somewhere. You can have mesenteric disease. You can have, just nodal recurrence and nothing else. So for which we really don't know whether we should actually do only a nodal dissection and does it add to the survival. So all these things have yet to be defined properly.
Why it is not endometrial carcinoma? Okay, are you here?
Yeah, I've already said that, it might be endometrial.
Yeah,
I said, did say that. It just might be endometrium.
Okay, are you here?
Yeah, I actually agree with all the comments. They're really good. And I usually defer to my pathologists about the primary source based on their pathologic examination. It also, I know it's hard for us to review slides in these conferences, but it would be very enriching if it's possible over time to include actually seeing the histopathology ourselves. How do you determine what the primary is? Maybe based on several factors. One might be the largest bulk of disease. The other, for instance, in fallopian tube is seeing a pre-invasive lesion and then transition to invasion. It's sort of hard to say. I basically defer to my pathologists on that. I definitely agree with the comments about giving her more chemotherapy. I would say, interestingly, I think there was also the comment about there's several phenotypes to ovarian cancer. There's the carcinomatosis, ascites, intra-abdominal spread, omental cake. And then there's the lymphatic spread with very little disease in the abdomen. And just anecdotally, the latter, that is the women with ovarian cancer that spreads by lymphadenopathy, they seem to have a better prognosis. So very interesting. Maybe it's probably related to whatever the molecular biology of their disease is. But anyway, so I completely agree with the comments. I'm not really sure how much more chemotherapy to consider. I think 3 cycles make sense. It's sort of arbitrary. Depending on her response and her bone marrow suppression and neuropathy and all those things. The other thing I would just bring up is, if we're calling this ovarian cancer, is there has been a trend towards maintenance therapy after the completion of primary therapy. And this is becoming normative and a standard of care. And you know, you have several options. One option is in the setting of BRCA positive women to give them olaparib, give them a PARP inhibitor for 2 years. In the setting of BRCA negative women, there's really discussion about giving them another PARP inhibitor called niraparib. And then there's also the pros and cons of adding a year of bevacizumab. There's a very good ASCO guidelines summary statement about maintenance therapy. I can send in, you know, a reference for that to y'all. But something for you to consider is that that is sort of a trend towards going to a year or two of maintenance therapy after you complete your primary therapy.
And in this, I would like to add one more point here, because this patient seems to be platinum sensitive disease. The first she was diagnosed in 2014, and then in 2020 later she had a nodal recurrence. So only on the basis of platinum sensitivity, she can be considered for PARP inhibitor, even if she is BRCA wild type. Yeah.
So in these cases, if the patient, they cannot afford or they disagree for BRCA testing, we can advise her the PARP inhibitor without BRCA testing.
If they are platinum sensitive, they have to be platinum sensitive in recurrent setting. Yeah.
Dr. Shana, I would like to ask the question to Dr. Rupinder. May I ask? Yes. Dr. Rupinder, thank you very much for your wonderful explanation. Just I want to know that you have said that this case might be a case of endometrial carcinoma. But according to CT, the CT report, uterus was normal in size, homogeneous, myometrium, and there is no endometrial cavity was clear. How does it can be a case of endometrial carcinoma?
Oh, your patient has already, she has undergone total hysterectomy in 2014. Only simple.
I have any report about that. So it could be a case of endometrial, because that was hysterectomy in 2014.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Not this case. So before anything, we either the maintenance therapy or everything, anything we can have to, or any adjuvant treatment, we must have to share about our histopathological diagnosis by ISC, whether it is typical the endometrioid type of carcinoma, ovarian carcinoma, or the endometrial carcinoma, endometrioid type, which is metastasis to the ovary. We must have to confirm it by ISC before starting any adjuvant therapy. Am I correct, ma'am?
Yes.
Yeah, that's right. By mentioned should have been done. And this, but then, you know, all these things are not very easily available everywhere.
So many times
we have to rely on our clinical judgment rather than all these IHC markers. And the most important aspect of this is that the patient has to be explained that a disseminated / recurrent endometrial carcinoma, where there is peritoneal spread or a nodal recurrence, is far worse than such a case for an ovarian carcinoma. So that has to be understood. So that is what makes it important, actually, to know the origin, whether it was really an endometrial CA or an ovarian CA. Otherwise, by and large, they're treated in much the same way.
Thank you, ma'am. Can we go for the next case?
Yes. Dr. Jobada, please proceed to next case.
Thank you, ma'am. My second case, Mrs. X, a 64-year-old menopausal woman, para 2, living 2, housewife of lower socioeconomic family, attended in M. Abdul Rahim Medical College and Hospital with the complaints of lower abdomen pain for 7 months, heaviness in the lower abdomen for same durations. According to the patient's statement, she was relatively all right 7 months back. Then she developed lower abdominal pain, which was dull, aching in nature, constant, and localized. She also complains of heaviness in the lower abdomen for 7 months. Her bowel and bladder habit was normal. there was no family history of breast, ovary, and colon cancer. On general admission, she was moderately anemic, non-icteric, thyroid gland not enlarged, accessible lymph node were not palpable, and breast showed no palpable lump. And on periabdominal examination, heart fixed mass palpable in the hypogastrium and also left iliac region. And there is on pelvic examination, heart fixed mass felt through the left fornix. Heart CT scan of whole abdomen showing bilateral complex adnexal mass with moderate ascites, and CA125 was raised, which was on 469 unit per ml. Then primary cytoreductive surgery conducted on 10th October 2021. And our histopathology report showing there was the serous carcinoma of the ovary with high grade, and FIGO staging was stage 3B. And patient received 6-cycle chemotherapy, which was completed on 3rd March 2022. Now patient was on regular follow-up.
My question to Dr. Bhagalakshmi Narayan, ma'am, what should be the ideal follow-up in this particular case?
Okay, so I think the surgery was went on very well, and she had the chemotherapy as was advised by the medical oncologist. So I think she has to be on follow-up. So there is no, we don't have anything else to do for her. But for the follow-up again, but coming to the hospital very regularly is also not so feasible for these patients. So I think in case she is, it's possible for her to follow up with some local doctor, I think it should be advised to her. In case she's, it's easy for her to access to your hospital, I think that's the best thing. But then if not, it's fine. So for us, the typical pattern of follow-up is that every 3 months for 2 years, then every 6 months for the next 3 years, then every yearly. But at the same time, whenever you are telling the patient to come back after 3 months, at the same time, we have to also tell the patient that if she has any complications or any problems in between, she has to come back. Because most of these cases are symptom-based. Most of the recurrences, the symptom comes first, and the imaging and marker and all those things come a little later. So I think we may be missing, even with our regular follow-up like this, we may be missing out the recurrences. So we can also tell them that in case they're not able to come to us regularly, if there is some symptom, they have to come back immediately. So first, every time when she comes back, I think we need to do a clinical examination. And then because luckily she had a marker high, so CA125 will be helpful. Because if the CA125 is not high at the first instance, so it may not be of much help. So I think we need to do, we can do a CA125 and some kind of imaging according to the availability and the resources. So if it's from a, if you have all the facilities, we can do the imaging and the marker each time she comes. But for us, we do it alternately. Each time, one time we do the marker, next time we do the imaging. We don't do both every time. So that's how we do. But one thing I would like to know that we usually we do a CEA also in this under the patient's all. So that many times some GI primary would also manifest like a primary ovarian. So I think CEA should always be also advised at the initial workup of these patients.
Thank you, madam. Thank you so much for your clear explanation. Thank you so much. Javada, please proceed to next case.
No, we have some questions here. We have some questions. Yeah. Sometimes, this patient, she did only the CT scan whole abdomen. She didn't, it was bilateral ovarian tumor. Bilateral?
Bilateral.
Ovarian tumor.
Bilateral.
When will you go for the, either the metastatic workup in case of the bilateral ovarian tumor? Do you routinely do metastatic workup, Dr. Rupendra ma'am or Bhagya Lakshmi ma'am?
They had a CT scan report which showed bilateral complex adnexal mass with moderate ascites.
Yeah.
So that is why I was thinking that if we have also, yes, because it's bilateral, she's quite an elderly patient. So I think CM should have been done at the first go only. So if the ratio of CA125 to CEA is more than 25, then we could think that it's ovarian. So if, because CA125 may be raised in so many conditions, including GI malignancy also when it comes to the peritoneal cavity. So if the ratio is less than less than 25, between CA125 and CA, then I think we have to think about some GI origin. So, and especially in elderly, even if the markers are not raised, I think it's ideal to do an endoscopy for this patient, especially in bilateral.
So, even if the
question, yes, about BRCA testing. So it should be done at the beginning and so I think BRCA testing should always be done at the beginning from the diagnosing a case of ovarian cancer. I think BRCA testing should be done from the beginning only.
For us also, whenever there are bile acid maxillary masses, we generally do a upper GI endoscopy as well as a colonoscopy.
So, what is your message for these doctors? When will you go for the GI workup or other workup in case of the ovarian, bilateral ovarian tumor? What is the clear message? Please, ma'am, give the clear message to these doctors.
So, the clear message is that, first of all, if the bilateral complex head neck cell masses, please make sure that you do at least a CEA, if not a CA 19.9. One would want to, the ideal circumstances would be that we do a CA 19.9 as well as a CEA. And we would definitely, if the CEA is just borderline, we would still want to do upper GI endoscopy as well as a colonoscopy. That is, it's definitely desirable.
And also,
bilateral ovarian tumor, and especially if there, sometimes there would be mobile also with ascites.
Also, if bilateral ovarian tumor along with the patient has the symptoms that either the vomiting or they said the parietal bleeding or constipation and the altered bowel habit, in that cases, if the patient, so we think that it is the bilateral ovarian tumor, it is mobile tumor, as a minimum ascites, so we are going for the surgery. And we must not do that before the going to any intervention. We must have to go toward the evaluation if the patient has any complaint of the either upper GI or lower GI complaint, any complaint, we must have to evaluate that. And another thing, what Dr. Rupendra ma'am was informed, that we must have to do the CA 99 level. Yeah.
See, Shahana, what I would like to say over here is that if the patient has any kind of a rectal bleed or hematemesis or vomiting or anything, then these patients, they present with those complaints, because the ovarian itself per se has got very few symptoms. Like we all know, it is a silent killer. So when the patient is presenting with these symptoms, you automatically address all these symptoms and do all the required investigations. So one has to keep that in mind. Don't wait for bilateral and nexal masses to appear before you start investigating your the GI tract.
And number two, I just wanted to tell that in case a colonoscopy is not available, a stool occult blood may be done.
Before colonoscopy, we must have to do the stool occult blood test, at least.
Or even a sigmoidoscopy. Even a sigmoidoscopy helps. So in case you don't have somebody who can do a complete colonoscopy, even if you can just put in a scope right in the sigmoid colon, it helps.
We have the question that sometimes the patients who are coming after they have doing the incomplete surgery, just either cystectomy or either unilateral sulfingophorectomy. In that cases, is there any role of re-staging, Dr. Seema Gulia ma'am? Sometimes patient that is early stage disease, they have come only just as unilateral ovarian and annexal mass without the raising the ovarian, the tumor marker. The patients are attended to us with only the unilateral sulfingophorectomy. In that cases, do you do the re-staging?
So we will repeat the CT scan to see the status of the disease, whether disease was limited only to that one adnexal region or it is widespread, because that surgery is definitely incomplete. So before the plan for surgery is there, our surgeon needs to know what is the extent of disease and whether upfront surgery, repeat surgery is possible, or we have to give neoadjuvant chemotherapy and then take the patient for interval debulking surgery?
No, ma'am. My question is, if there is the patient has just her, all the tumor marker was normal, all tumor marker, that's a simple adnexal mass, and the doctor, they did the only unilateral salpingoperectomy and they report towards the malignancy. In that case,
surgery has to be done in this
Then surgery has to be done because the surgery is incomplete.
What is the advantage to the message to all the participants? What is the advantage of the resurgery or re-staging?
What is the staging laparotomy? It is as per protocol.
Yeah.
It is a staging laparotomy. So we have to know the stage of the disease. We have to know how much it has spread.
Yeah.
So that we can plan the adjuvant treatment accordingly.
Okay.
But there is yet another situation. Dr. Seema would like to take your opinion, because after 3 cycles of chemotherapy, the disease has disappeared completely. Like, there is, the markers are normal, the PET CT is normal. So what do we do with these patients? And the patient doesn't want to take a surgery. She tells, I'm completely free of disease. Why should I be operated?
See, in ovarian cancer, nothing can replace the complete surgery. No amount of chemotherapy or any targeted therapy can cover up for the incomplete surgery. And if it is, patient has undergone only cystectomy upfront and then chemotherapy and then repeat CT scan doesn't show any disease, still we have to counsel the patient, and patient should undergo completion surgery.
Okay. Because I had a patient, so she didn't agree for surgery, came back with, again, she had 3 cycles of chemotherapy and now has come back with multiple neck nodes. And now she wants a surgery.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a really good question. On the one hand, academically, the best surgery, the most comprehensive staging is always something we want to do. It may alter follow-up chemotherapy and so forth. And it may be that you identify disease that was missed. In fact, there is a study from a long, long time ago that looked at the incidence of upstaging based on comprehensive surgery, and it was about 20%. So disease was missed at the first surgery that was up on the diaphragm and so forth. Having said that, if you have someone where another surgery is a big burden and you don't think clinically it's going to alter your course, you could be a little bit more pragmatic about it and, you know, base your decision on tumor markers or x-rays and so forth. But yeah, no, my first position would be to do comprehensive surgery, yes.
Shannon,
Professor
Shannon, are there any question?
Yes, there is a question in the chat box. They say, how do we benefit young unmarried female in third decade by doing uterine sparing ovarian surgery for bilateral ovarian germ cell tumor or low grade serous carcinoma ovary with no peritoneal disease?
I think first of all, it should not be done, because in germ cell tumor also you can salvage the other ovary because they are very, very chemosensitive. And even in low grade serous carcinoma, you can take a chance if the other ovary is absolutely normal. But then still, if she's young and is very anxious for a pregnancy, I think we can counsel her and leave the ovary, because there are so many, too much advances in ART. So she can have a artificial reproductive technology with ovum donation.
Dr. Seema, have you any comment?
Yes, I agree with Dr. Bhagya Lakshmi that you have to counsel the patient that though we are going ahead with fertility sparing surgery, but definitely there is an increased chance of recurrence. And if patient understands and is ready to take that risk, then in select group of patients, we can advise them regarding fertility sparing surgery.
So if it is low grade serous carcinoma, how much cycle of chemotherapy do you advise? 3 cycle or 6 cycle?
In six, a very difficult question to answer because in low grade carcinoma, the benefit of chemotherapy is not great.
Yeah.
But as per the standard guidelines,
yeah,
the patient are advised to undergo chemotherapy, knowing the fact that the benefit will be only 2-3%. Because only this many percentage of patients will respond to chemotherapy, rest will not. But definitely in low-grade serous carcinoma, we should advise them that they should take maintenance hormonal therapy. There is enough evidence to suggest that in low-grade serous carcinoma, maintenance hormone therapy definitely increases the progression-free survival. And there is a very good paper in JCO from MD Anderson group, where they have shown that the progression-free interval tripled by giving maintenance hormonal therapy in low-grade serous. So that is one thing which we should advocate to our patients.
At primary level, at the preliminary, after
yes,
the completion at, surgery,
yeah, after initial
immediately, surgery, immediately after surgery, you will advise her the maintenance hormone therapy or after recurrence?
No.
After chemotherapy.
After chemotherapy. First, they will undergo surgery, then chemotherapy, and then maintenance hormone therapy.
This how many cycle chemotherapy? 3 or 6 cycles?
Six cycles. There is no evidence to suggest that 3 is better than 6.
And another question, Seema Gulia ma'am, to you, that the if it is the mucinous carcinoma, in that case, what type of chemotherapy you advise? Either paclitaxel carboplatin or other?
No.
In your mucinous ovary?
Yeah, in mucinous ovary, till date, the data is only for paclitaxel and carboplatin, though some trials are ongoing where they are trying to utilize the GI-based protocol, but those results are still not out. So till date, paclitaxel and carboplatin remains the standard of care.
But before that, we must have to confirm that it is IC-based,
yeah,
it is primary ovary mucinous.
That we,
yeah, not GI, yeah, primary, yeah.
Yes.
And in case of the clear cell carcinoma?
Clear cell carcinoma, again, paclitaxel carboplatin.
Okay. I think you should proceed over the next case. Yeah.
Dr. Jobada, please proceed for the next case.
Okay, ma'am. Our third case is 60 years old menopausal woman, para 2 living 2, housewife of lower socioeconomic family, attendant in M. Abdul Rahim Medical College and Hospital, with the complaints of non-case of malignant ovarian tumor and received 6 cycle neoadjuvant chemotherapy up to 1st February 2022. According to the patient's statement, she was admitted in Lucan Clinic for right-sided ovarian tumor on July 2021. On that time, all her tumor marker and ultrasonogram suggested for benign ovarian tumor. Then laparoscopic removal of tumor was done by surgery consultant at local clinic. But unfortunately, her histopathology report was papillary serous cyst adenocarcinoma. Then she referred to an oncologist and 6-cycle chemotherapy was given. After completion of chemotherapy, she was advised to admit our hospital in Abdul Rahim Medical College for further next management. There was no family history of breast, ovary, and colon cancer. Her bowel and bladder habit was normal. On general, there was no abnormalities detected, and per abdominal examination, soft, non-tender, no mass is palpable. On pelvic examination, there was no mass is felt through the fornix. RCT abdomen showing post-operative status of right ovary, no residual tumor present, CA-120 normal, less than 5 units per ml, CA-79.48 units per ml. Then her laparotomy done, total abdominal hysterectomy with bilateral sulfingo oophorectomy with total omentectomy on 1st March 2022. Her histopathology report is pending.
Thank you, Dr. Jubaida. Have you finished?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Our patient said.
I would like to ask a question to Professor Seema Gulia, madam. This patient is 60 years old and she had a history of unilateral ovarian tumor. What's the role of unilateral sulfingo oophorectomy in case of HA domain like this particular case, 60 years of old lady. And what's the role of laparoscopy in case of malignant ovarian tumor?
Yeah, so role of laparoscopy, I think Dr. Rupender or Dr. Bhagyashri can explain it better, the role of laparoscopy in ovarian cancer. But unilateral salping or oophorectomy, I don't think there is a role in ovarian cancer in any stage. It has to be comprehensive surgical staging. And in this patient, CA 19.9, I think it is slightly on the higher side. I don't know what is the normal limit for your laboratory, but it is on the higher side. And her CA 125 was never high. So I would definitely would like to look at the final histopathology report before deciding on what would be the next line of therapy.
Thank you, madam.
And she has responded to paclitaxel.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Because there was no evidence of any disease on her CT scan or clinical examination.
Patient, if her histopathology report, there is the report is like that, there is no residual disease. In that case, what will be her next treatment plan? Simabulia, ma'am, we'll advise more cycle of chemotherapy.
So what was the HPR on the first salping oophorectomy? Sorry, I missed that.
Serous cyst adenocarcinoma, high grade.
High grade serous adenocarcinoma, in that case, if she has tolerated chemotherapy well, I will advise her two more cycles of paclitaxel and carboplatin.
Even after all the reports are normal after completion.
Even if HPR does not reveal. See, because as I mentioned in the beginning, treatment of ovarian cancer cannot end at surgery. After surgery, we have to give them adjuvant chemotherapy. Either two or three cycles, depending upon the tolerance to the previous neoadjuvant chemotherapy and any residual neuropathy that we have to look at. I mean, she might be a candidate for only two cycles of single agent carboplatin if she has some residual neuropathy at present after six cycles of chemotherapy.
If the patient had the report comes, there is the omental metastasis or the residual disease in the other ovary, in that cases,
then I would like to give her at least three cycles of chemotherapy.
Okay, 3 cycles.
Yes, because after chemotherapy, surgery is a little tricky. We would be missing out some microscopic disease which are not evident. So soon after you finish your surgery, she may come back again with recurrence after. So I think it's ideal to follow it up with at least 2 cycles of chemotherapy, even if the HPR is negative.
Madam, what's the ideal time to start chemotherapy following operation, following surgery?
Yeah,
what's the ideal time to start chemotherapy following surgery?
Yes, we usually follow it up after 2 weeks only when the wound has healed properly and the patient's general condition has improved, so that she would be able to withstand the complications of chemotherapy like vomiting and all those things. So at least 2 weeks.
Yeah, and in fact, there is some retrospective evidence which shows that patient who started chemotherapy 21 days after their surgery, their outcome was poor compared to those who started chemotherapy before 21 days post-surgery. So 2 weeks is an ideal time, but definitely we have to make sure that wound has healed well and there's no evidence of infection.
Thank you, madam. Thank you for your clear message.
So there is another question in the chat box. In older women, should we do laparoscopic surgery for adnexal masses, even it look benign on imaging and the normal marker?
In this particular case,
to be 200% sure about your diagnosis and take all the precaution that you don't spill it, because you never know, after the biopsy may come out something else. So I think you have to be very careful that you don't spill inside. So I think
not only inside
a bag and take it out. So I think spillage is the woman carries a very bad prognosis if you spill the tumor. So
not only that, ma'am, in that cases, we can do the laparoscopic surgery by keeping the frozen facilities available.
Yes. There's no facilities.
Yeah, these facilities, it's not a discredit, because where the frozen facilities is not available, in that cases, we can shift it over to the imprint cytology, because the in maximum center where they do the frozen facilities, they do the imprint cytology. And it is just simple.
Yes, frozen is not available everywhere. So I think
that case is
we have to be very friendly with your pathologist.
Yeah, we must have to if you take a meeting with your pathologist and thus encourage them, and if you regularly do this, I think they will help you and they will do this deeper in cytology, because it will be very much helpful for your decision making in cases where there is suspicious cases, but tumor marker as normal. In that case, you can do the completion surgery or the conservative surgery. So imprint cytology, you must have to accustom to with your histopathology or cytopathology friends.
Most of Indian younger women, when you're thinking about fertility sparing and all those things, I think those cases also you will need your pathologist friend's help. Yeah. If there is frozen, it's well and good. If not, I think imprint smear has to be taken.
There is another question. It is, in this patient, should we do re-laparotomy before chemotherapy?
Hello. Yes, I think usually in our practice, if you see that the patient has had some kind of laparoscopic surgery and we can do a re-surgery and it's an operable case, I think we go ahead with surgery first. But then we think it's an inoperable case and we will be again doing an incomplete surgery, and patient suppose recently has had a big surgery, patient may not like to undergo a surgery again. So in these cases, you have to sometimes compromise and taking into account the patient's choice, her health condition, everything, and then decide upon whether to send her for chemotherapy or do a revision surgery when she comes to you.
AK, are you here?
Of course I'm here.
Yeah. What is your comment?
I agree with the comment.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, please go.
If a patient, the attendant, like these patients, if he attended to us after the laparoscopic surgery, and in that cases, by doing all the advanced imaging and examination, if I think that it can complete the excision can be possible, in that case, I think it should be the best treatment, the primary debulking surgery, then we will advise for the adjuvant chemotherapy. What is your opinion?
I think that's very reasonable. Totally. You know, you make these calls based on multiple factors. Pure, if you had every resource available and there was no delay in getting back to the operating room and there wasn't going to be a queue and all these sorts of things, clearly resecting everything comprehensively is very good. There definitely are times, and I have this in Boston, where I cannot get someone on the operating room schedule and I'm going to put in a few doses of chemotherapy because I don't want to wait. And then I'll get her back to the operating room in 6 weeks or something like that. It can be crazy busy. And I know you have queues as well. So those are the balances in an ideal world versus pragmatically, what are we dealing with in terms of our resources and so forth. I actually also wanted to maybe, since I have the floor for a moment, comment on the previous question, which I think is a really great question, which is, what if you have normal tumor markers and by imaging study, a benign appearing adnexal cyst in a postmenopausal woman, do you just routinely go ahead and operate on these ladies or do you leave it alone? That's a really interesting question. You know, it's in some ways, when we know what the punchline is, we know the answer, right? We know what to do. But so many ladies will have benign little bubbles on their ovaries and fallopian tubes and hydrosalpinxes and so forth. And do you operate on everybody? And that's a very, very tough call, especially if you have limited resources and limited time in the operating room. So I have a personal grid that I use. I use, are they symptomatic? And if they are symptomatic, absolutely. They have pain, there's something going on. They might have torsion, even if I think it's benign, they need surgery. Is it changing over time, right? That would be another reason to take them to the operating room. And then the final criterion I use again, in the setting where something is absolutely benign, it's less than 4 centimeters in size, it's unilocular, there are tumor markers are normal. The other thing I use is family history. So I take a comprehensive family history, I back up and I say, is there breast cancer in the family? Is there ovarian cancer? Is there colon cancer? You know, and based on that, I might say, maybe I should consider this as a risk reducing opportunity, even if this is going to be benign, that potentially you are doing preventative medicine. Very interestingly, in this month's issue of Journal of Obstetrics and Gynecology, was a very interesting study that came out that looked at thousands and thousands of women, retrospective study, who had benign surgery, hysterectomies with or without sparing of the ovaries. And there was a very significant reduction in ovarian cancer. And these are women who are low risk for ovarian cancer. It's very interesting, you know, because we've been trending towards, when we do hysterectomies for fibroids and dysplasia and so forth, thinking about sparing the ovaries because of the cardioprotective risk, right? So just very interesting. So just wanted to add that to the conversation.
Okay, thank you very much. I think we are at the end of the session.
Shana. Yes. There is a case of persistent gestational trophoblastic neoplasia, which was ready. Can we show the case?
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, we can go first.
Yeah, first. Because thank you, ma'am. It's already 10:30. We have the all of the office okay. To move. Yeah.
Dr. Aisha, please. Thank you, Dr. Jobaida and Ishrat. And now it's the time for Dr. Tasneem Aisha to present her case.
Whether please stop your slide share.
Please continue with one device, please. There is echo, huh? Okay, start, please. Quick. Please unmute. We can hear.
Can you hear me?
Yes. You start can from you hear me? First slide. Yes, now we can hear. Please start from first slide.
And can you hear me?
Yes.
Oh. And on histopathology report.
No, let's start from first slide.
Oh, yeah.
Please go back.
Mrs. X, 22 years, Para 1, Living 1, admitted in M. Abdul Rahim Medical College Hospital, Dinajpur on 19 December 2020 with the complaints of irregular parvaginal bleeding for 3 months. And history of suction and evacuation for molar pregnancy on 1 September 2020, 3 months back. Her histopathology report shows hydatidiform mole. And on 31 August 2020, her pre-evacuation beta ECG was 2,50,000 milli-international unit. But after that, her beta ECG level was decreasing. But on 29 October 2020, her beta ECG level was raised up to 1,6,500 milli-international unit per ml. And her weekly beta ECG follow-up was not maintained. So post-evacuation ultrasonogram was not done. And she was lost to follow-up for 2 months. and on examination she was severely anemic, blood pressure 60 over 40 millimeter of mercury, pulse 160 beats per minute, respiratory rate 40 breaths per minute, and no sign of focal neurological deficit. On parabdominal examination, abdomen was tense, tender, and hugely distended. And on pelvic examination, parvaginal bleeding present, size of uterus couldn't be delineated due to tender abdomen, and no nodules in vulva, vagina, and suburethral region. And her ultrasonogram of whole abdomen shows retained molar tissue within the uterus and moderate ascites. And another ultrasonogram report shows uterus bulky, mixed echogenic structure showed in the uterine cavity, and huge collection of free fluid is seen in the intraperitoneal cavity and pouch of Douglas, and huge ascites. And chest X-ray reveals normal, and beta ECG level was more than 1 lakh milli international unit per ml, and hemoglobin level was 4.8 gram per dl. And on the decision from the tumor board, we will aspirate, we will paracentesis done. And this is the picture was that. So our diagnosis, this is the case of persistent gestational trophoblastic disease, maybe perforating mole. And we do prognostic score index for gestational trophoblastic in neoplasia. In this score, her stage one and score four. And we, after that, we laparotomy was done. And after an incision, there was a perforating mole on the right-sided of the right-sided corner of the uterus. And left ovary and right ovary was healthy and enlarged. And this is the after cross-section of the uterus. This shown molar tissue. And after 48 hours after surgery, her beta ECG level was 7,788 milli international unit per ml. And on 30 December 2020, her beta ECG level was 1,177 milli international unit per ml. And then beta ECG level was done weekly, and which was shown decreasing on 3rd March 2021, which was 130 milli international unit per ml. And again, she was lost to follow up, and we call her over telephone. And on 9 July 2021, her beta ECG level was 11 milli international unit per ml. And she was follow up. And her beta ECG level was within the normal limit up to 3 consecutive negative. Thank you, madam.
Thank you, Dr. Tasnim, for a beautiful case presentation with photographs. Now, Professor Shahnara. Professor Shahnara Parveen.
Yes, yes. This patient, this case was discussed in, yes, this case was discussed in the tumor board in oncology club, and after that time it was, we advised her for doing the colpopuncture, and after colpopuncture, that's why there is huge the abdominal collection and also the hemoglobin 4, and after that there is the peritoneal, the blood in the peritoneal cavity, and immediately they resuscitated the patient, and after that they did the surgery, and they are very happy. And so how can we, when we want to give you the message, all of you, that by, if you are with us and you, we attend the regular, regularly with this tumor board or with this session, we can upgrade ourselves, and also we can treat our patients accordingly, and we can give the, our patients the best service even after in low resource settings. Dr. Bhagyalakshmi, ma'am, your comment, please.
Yes, I think it was, correctly managed at the correct time, because that if you would have delayed a little bit, I think you would have lost the patient, because she was in such a bad shape. But I think if counseling for such complications should have been given from the beginning, so I think this is a complication that have, that could happen with any molar pregnancy. So some as right, very rightly mentioned, she has not done any post-molar ultrasound, no imaging was done after that. But though I think the beta ECG was falling, then I think it has started
No, she's in follow-up and her case is with the normal immediate postponal ultrasound was done. She didn't show it here and everything. She is now, the patient is now okay, completely okay. And her BTS is in I think 11 months.
What was the age of the
patient?
What was the age of the patient?
22.
So how many kids she had, children?
One child.
Okay, thank you. Yes, I think that was the best treatment that could have been done in that situation.
And he's no more faculty. So I would like to comment on today's program. Dr. AFM Kamaluddin Bhai. Kamaluddin Bhai, please.
So thank you, Shahana. Hi sir said that today we had a host guest, that is Bhagga, and also AK, because both of them are no more guests. And I congratulate the Rangpur team. I mean, wonderful. I was really amazed.
Dinajpur.
So, but Appa is not from Dinajpur.
Yes, she is now posted.
No, I am now in Dinajpur. I have been transferred.
So I was thinking Rangpur because. Okay. So I was considering everything Rangpur because Appa was basically from Rangpur. Okay. So Dinajpur. So I mean, then you should deserve double congratulations because you know they are very near to India, and there is a part in India named Dinajpur. And I went through that. So Dinajpur is divided, half is in India, half is in Bangladesh. And that part is also Dinajpur. So they are more near to India than to us now at this moment. So congratulations to the Dinajpur team. And we have arranged this program this time to avoid lectures and academic things, to bring up the everyday issue. Because every day, everybody is facing challenges. And when they are in a periphery setup like Dinajpur, where they don't have many resources, I know sometimes they struggle like anything. So how they face this challenge and how they can overcome is, that is the main objective. And I'm happy that Dr. Seema Gulia, Rupinder, and AK, along with Bhagya, was trying to show them some light and ray of hope and way out how to face these challenges. And I believe that within last few years, the amount of development that happened in our country, especially in the field of gyne-oncology, that is really amazing. And what I respect is the response of gynecologists. They are really interested to understand and improve themselves so that they can give a real support to our patients. And credit goes to Shahana and our friends from overseas who are continuously supporting us. And Oncology Club will be continuing this effort, and they are there to respond to you. Whatever is your need, there we can want to address to solve it. Country like Bangladesh cannot have all formal teaching because we don't have that much resources. So we have to learn on need-based patient. Where there is a need, we need to fill it up. Like this, we need to continue because Bhagya is in a part of India where it totally simulates with our picture. All the socioeconomic status is totally same. So she knows the challenges, what we are facing. That's why they can really understand our problem and we can really overcome. And thanks to Shahana, your team, now you can, I think Shahana can take up some projects of doing some event management of academic programs because her team is now so expert, she can handle others' program on a professional basis. Your team is really wonderful, hats off to you. And keep it up, and we want to see that this should continue. And end of the day, the things should improve, and we should have a better future for our patients, because I always say that technology may not be there, resource may not be there, but knowledge should not have any boundary. We should have the knowledge at least. So we may think that as we don't have the resource, we could not offer, but we should not struggle for knowledge. So we should be hungry for knowledge. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Nawaluddin. Thank you very much. Hi, sir.
Hello.
Sir, thank you, sir. Please conclude the session. It is too late, sir.
I am very happy. The session was very good, very informative and very interesting. And I have to thank again to Dinajpur Medical College, Medical College. Hopefully they will participate again in the future. One thing I wanted to say, we have some participants from outside Bangladesh. If you have faced any problem, you can send us those problems. We can hear as well. We are open, we can take your problems as well. Robert, thank you all very much, particularly Magdalene and Anna Catherine and all the participants. Goodbye and assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you for giving us the opportunity. Thank you, Oncology Club.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you all the international faculties and national faculties.
So for each webinar, I think she is losing some days in her life. So much of stress for her. Anyway, but all the good things that you are doing ultimately is translating into good patient care. So you'll get all the good fortune about for that. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. You're most welcome.
Yeah. I think we should conclude.
Thank you.
Please.
Thank you.
Conclude the session.
Okay. Assalamu alaikum. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.